Tēnei te mihi. Ngā mihi nui ki o tātou Kaikōrero, Veronica Tawhai, Darryn Ui, and Tim McCreanor. Ngā mihi nui ki o tātou Kaituao, producer Nikki, moderator Rochelle, rawa ko Catherine, who will transcribe the captions. Tēnā koutou katoa, I whānau mai ahau I Adelaide, I te whenua moimoia, ko te gauna, te tangata whenua, o te rā rohi. Kei te noho ahau ki Tāmaki Makaurau e nāianei, te whenua o tā o Ngāti Whātua o Ōrākei. Ko Jenny Rankin tāko ingoa, he Pākehā ahau, mei te heamana o tēnei zoe, nō reira. Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā rā tātou katoa. Welcome to this important webinar on Matike Mai, planning for constitutional transformation. We acknowledge all those whose lands we are standing on today. We acknowledge all of you attending from the four winds, all corners of the world, overseas, as well as in Aotearoa, New Zealand, who support Te Tiriti o Waitangi. We greet our speakers, Veronica Tawhai, Darryn Ui, and Tim McCreanor. We also thank our producer, moderator, and caption volunteers. My name is Jenny Rankin, and I'm your chair. This webinar uses a fireside chat format. Each kaikōrero speaks individually first, and then they respond to each other's kōrero and to your questions in the Q&A at the bottom of your screen. This series of webinars has a community code. We are curious, open, and respectful. We make generous assumption about each other, that we are all capable and worthy of compassion. We take the lessons and we are confidential about the details that are shared in these webinars. We speak from our own experience rather than generalising to groups of people or presuming anything about anyone's experience. We speak with I statements rather than you always. No one knows everything, together we know a lot. If we usually speak often, take the opportunity to learn more deeply or to listen more deeply. If we tend to be quiet, take the chance to speak. We can't be articulate all the time, none of us, and we don't, this is last but not least, we don't take ourselves too seriously. So without further ado, as they say, ngā mihi nui ki a Veronica Tawhai, who was convener of Te Rangatahi Rōpū, the youth organisation for the Matike Mai consultation, and is a lecturer in policy and politics at Massey University. Go, Veronica.
Ahui anō, tēnā tātou katoa. Tukuna hoki waku mihi I roto I ngā tini āhuatanga o te wā. Anō reira ngā mate o te wā, tukuna rātou kia okioki rātou kia rātou, hoi anō hoki tātou kia tātou te hunga ora me te mihi ki te atāhuatanga o tā tātou kaupapa. A Matike Mai Aotearoa, anō reira tēnā tātou katoa. Kia ora everyone, welcome to our webinar. Thank you so much for the organisers of this really important kaupapa. It would have seemed whānau, we're a few weeks deep now into the Te Tiriti Based Futures and Anti-Racism kaupapa. So just like to mihi to all of those organisers and speakers that have contributed their thoughts and time to our kaupapa to date. And so really lucky this morning to be speaking about Matike Mai Aotearoa, which is core both to an anti-racism based future here in Aotearoa, but anti-racist approaches are also going to be key to understanding Matike Mai Aotearoa and progressing it. So just a big shout out also to my co-speakers, kia ora you wonderful men. Very privileged to be going first. So yes, whānau, Matike Mai Aotearoa, just to give a quick kōrero for those of you who are just learning or coming into this kaupapa. So Matike Mai Aotearoa is just the new name that we give to something that's fairly old. For those of you who are coming into your journey on learning about Te Tiriti o Waitangi, as you will know, 1840, Aotearoa, is a country that is based off Māori laws and Māori ways of doing things, what we refer to kawa and tikanga. And really in Te Tiriti o Waitangi, and in particular in Article 1, what we have done is that Māori have been incredibly innovative in terms of that we have welcomed in a new type of authority to sit alongside Māori authority in the governance of what was becoming a significant Pākehā population. And so we know that we have our British ancestors, our European ancestors who are coming here. There are enough of them to form maybe a small hapū, you know, not too big whānau, but a smallish hapū. And, you know, do these people have a rangatira, you know, or someone that governs their lives? Yes, but they're not here in Aotearoa. We know that there's one over in Australia and another one all the way over in England. And so really what Māori we're being asked to consider is that alongside all of our rangatira, you know, who help organise and run Māori society, are we going to, or would we consider the presence of a rangatira for the Pākehā? There were a few things in there, whānau, as you are deepening your understanding on what it is that's exactly written in our Te Tiriti. There were some things that were quite radical about this idea, and that is that whereas we know that, you know, Māori power and authority is based on mana whenua, or it might be where you, your particular genealogical ties are to a particular land area, and so that is where you might exercise your spiritual political authority. What was being asked in terms of ka wanatanga is that actually the governor or the authority of the governor was able to reach across to wherever our Pākehā were, wherever, you know, these European, just British subjects at this point, but then to become settlers were. And I'm always amazed at how amazingly innovative and generous our Māori ancestors were, that we said yes, that this was a huge, you know, development in terms of constitutional power and authority, the way things were going to operate here in Aotearoa, but that as per our tikanga, as per the tikanga kawa that was already here in this country, that this is something that we were willing to, you know, welcome in as a part of, you know, as a part of our relationship and ongoing development of this relationship with the British monarchy. And so this is what it looks like in 1840 whānau, but what we know is that over time, and particularly beginning in those 1860s, what we have, to put in very simple terms, is the encroachment of ka wanatanga and the governance of ka wanatanga over everybody. You know, that includes other rangatira, that includes Māori. And now we have a narrative of the idea that actually that when Māori agreed to ka wanatanga, it wasn't just over British subjects, that it was over everyone. Now, yeah, we don't quite have time to go into this deep history, whānau, but just to encourage you to read into what's happening in that 1860 period where ka wanatanga is initially extended. It doesn't have anything to do really with our Te Tiriti text or the Treaty of Waitangi text, okay? Just to note that there is this huge myth that the conflicts that occurred in our history is because we have these differences in our text and there were mistranslations and, you know, poor Māori, you didn't quite know what you were signing. What we now know, whānau, as a result of the wonderful evidence that the Waitangi Tribunal has produced over the last four decades, is that none of that is the case. And there are actually some really good things in the Treaty of Waitangi. But what has happened is that we've gone through this period of time here in Aotearoa where both those treaties have simply been thrown out. Unfortunately, that is the same time that then ka wanatanga or the right of governance, you know, by a British system is extended over Māori. And it is also the time that we just happen to be building our country in terms of what we know it today to be, in terms of the education system, the health system, the political system, the representation system. And you know, whānau, you only have to go back to have a look at that time itself. Why is it in the first place that ka wanatanga has been extended over Māori? What then happens in terms of the decisions that are made about Māori lives? Well, all of that time is really entrenched in that period, which is about settler colonialism, and which of course is, you know, characterised by those myths around Indigenous inferiority, or, you know, what is also referred to as white supremacy. And so one of the massive challenges that we face today, whānau, is that one, we now have a kāwanatanga system that has extended over everyone whose roots are in the idea that Māori are inferior Indigenous peoples that need governing by others. The second thing is that, you know, we have this huge now history of harm in terms of some of the things that were established at that time that definitely need to be addressed to work towards a more just future. But further than that and beyond that, whānau, is that even if we did reach a part in society, say, where the saying is we're Māori, we're just as happy and just as healthy and just as educated as others, for etc. Does that mean then that we don't worry about Te Tiriti or Waitangi, or that underneath, you know, deeper than that, that we don't worry about, you know, tikanga or kawa or Māori ways of doing things? And the answer is, you know, of course not. You know, that actually beyond the resolving of these historical injustices, that actually there is a future, you know, that we can all engage with in terms of what is then more, you know, what is actually going to be the basis of that justice, and that's recognising what might be the constitutional basis for this country. And I just want to read a quote by Moana about that. And just to further explain, whānau, if for those of you listening from outside the New Zealand context, it's because there's a huge assumption that Te Tiriti or Waitangi or acknowledging Māori culture has only got to do with the resolution of all this harm, all this historical harm that has been done. We're really, Matike Mai is about how is it that we can continue into the future in a way that is just, not only in terms of ensuring you know, the conditions from which Māori can experience health and well-being, but actually what was that initial vision of welcoming others here so that we all might thrive in a place where the tikanga and kawa or the laws and protocols you know, of this country are enjoyed by everyone. And so I'll just read this quote by Moana that really explains that wonderfully. So this is an excerpt from a talk that he gave in 2012 at the United Nations Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues, where the theme was on the doctrine of discovery. Okay. What he says is that the aim should not be just to recompense for the past actions, but to accept that a better and more just future for Indigenous peoples will ultimately require a restoration of the political and constitutional authority which the colonizing states have so consistently sought to oppress. He then goes on and says, and this is, I consider to be one of our foundation Matike Mai whakatauki or quotes, as he says, a constitution for our land must come from our land. We believe that the imposed colonizing constitution from Britain grew from that place, and that we must find something which breathes from the stories in our own land. We further undertake the work confident that the notion of democracy and indeed the very concept of political power itself are not unique to Britain or Western Europe, but have roots deeply grounded in our own history and traditions. Yep. Cool. So kia ora moana. And so the last thing that I just wanted to say about that, whānau, was that in terms of this being an old idea, it's that if you go through our history, Māori have a long constitutional history in terms of from the very moment that kāwanatanga expanded from a governor to a settler parliament, Māori have attempted to engage in that system, starting with Tarapipipi in 1855, where he actually makes the first co-governance proposal. And right from that time, Māori have you know, explored and put all our efforts into trialing a range of things, be it Māori parliaments, be it co-governance arrangements, be it autonomous Māori movements. And so Matike Mai is really just the most recent name to this long-term effort to ensure that actually what was agreed to in Te Tiriti o Waitangi, which is that the tikanga and kawa of this place, in terms of our own spiritual political laws, can continue to live and breathe in this country as the best thing, you know, for these lands and for everyone on these lands. And so I probably should just stop there.
Kia ora, Veronica. Thank you very much for that deep background and talking about some of those myths, totally essential for any conversation about the future. Right, now we'll mihi nui kia Darryn Oi, who is a Te Tiriti educator. Darryn.
Kia ora, Jenny. Tūtahi mihi kia koutou katoa. E tautou koutou mihi a Jenny, Veronica, hoki o kōrua kōrero, o kōrua mihi ki ngā mana whenua, ki ngā tangata wehe atūrā. Ai, kia ora kōrua, e mihi hoki ki tēnei kaupapa o Te Tiriti-based futures. No haina oku tupuna, no merehia oku mātua i hunuku, oku mātua ki konei, ki tāmaki makaurau, i whānau mai, i tūpū ake au ki konei. So, yep. Nōku te tino waimarie ki te kōrero ki a koutou katoa, no reira e mihi anō ki a koutou e huihui mai moata i tēnei wā. Thank you so much, everyone. It's a real privilege to be here, and really, I was told this was a very relaxed chat and then heard about how many people have signed up and this was just meant to be a really chill fireside chat, so that's the approach that I'll have. I just wanted to note a few things, of course. I have a background, I am a member of Asian Sporting Tino Rangatiratanga, also a member of the Asian Legal Network, but I just want to make clear, and then also, you know, currently doing workshops about Te Tiriti, but I just wanted to also note that I'm not speaking on behalf of any of those hats, I'm speaking on behalf of me, and drawing, I think, from those experiences as well. And so I just wanted to, you know, so I'm really lucky to be part of a lot of these different kaupapa and the questions of what does it mean to be, you know, Tangata Tiriti, what does Matike Mai mean, and what does the future really look like? And so I thought an appropriate place is to start with a couple of stories that have really changed, you know, and helped me think a lot more about this question, or these questions. The first is, we had a really, you know, we're really fortunate in our last conversation that we had is Esther with Pāmoana. We visited him in Waimana in February 2022. And he spoke of this kōrero which Mangju, and I should mihi to everyone else in Esther, Mangju was there as well. And Mangju's written up an article about this, being a part of Moana's legacy. And in that last conversation, he gave us a kōrero about his kōrō, who was in Te Tai Rāwhiti, and he was very outspoken against Asian racism, Chinese racism, and what happened was that there was a Chinese market gardening couple who had their land sort of destroyed by whanaunga of this rangatira, and instead of going to the police, they went to him, and he called them in and he sort of sorted out the raru. And I've always thought that was a really fascinating way of choosing who you want to resolve your problems, who you give mana to. And that's been sitting at the back of my mind, you know, for the last couple of years. The next thing that I think was quite relevant is during that year, I was really fortunate to go to Te Wānanga Takiura to learn Te Reo Rangatira. And one of the opportunities we had was to go to Koroneihana. Now, I'd learned about the Kingitanga, I went to Papawai, heard about, you know, all these constitutional movements in the past, but it was the first time in 2022, you know, it was the first time after a couple of years because of COVID, there were so many people, you know, and in the first day there's a kawe mate, and then the second day you have all these iwi, you know, that come and speak from across the motu, right? Politicians don't get a say until the last day. And as we were listening, you know, we were halfway through a year, so we could understand a fair bit of reo, and then, you know, someone from Te Opauru would speak, and then from another iwi, Kahungunu Tuhoi, and then this person stands up and he starts speaking, and I'm like, I'm pretty sure that's a language of Te Moana Nui a Kiwa. I couldn't really understand. And then some of the rangatahi were like, oh my goodness, I have no idea what he's saying, you know? And then a matua who was listening was like, oh, that's because he's speaking in the mita of Ngāpuhi. So they always speak like that, you don't understand them. But actually, then the kaikōrero stops, he starts speaking in English and says, I'm actually here from Fiji, from the Fijian community. And then they all sort of, all the rangatahi sort of look at this matua and each other just laughs at them. But what he said, this kaikōrero from the Fijian community was, I apologize, you know, we've been here for decades and this is the first time that I'm here and I want to acknowledge you, the king, and your authority. And I thought, well, that's actually really fascinating, you know. And he was invited to do so, and he gave a taonga. And that also sat with me as something really fascinating, you know, the sort of direct recognition, right? Turning away again from the crown. And then the last thing that I found really fascinating was at the start of my journey at Te Wānangatakiura, I would stand up and say, oh, you know, no hai no kutupuna, oh, he tangata tiriti ahau, you know, and then that was really, it gives you that sort of space to speak, you know. But then we went to a tangihanga of a friend's father in Tūhoe, and we arrived there, and me and a friend were the only tāne, and we were like, oh my goodness, do we have to speak, you know, at the pōhiri? And one of our kaiako arrives, but he, and then we were like, oh, thank goodness, he's going to speak for us. But then he was like, oh, e kao, e ora tonu tōku papa, so no re ehara titika. You know, the tikanga is, if your dad's still alive in Tūhoe, you can't speak. So he actually told us, you guys have to speak, but, you know, just make a connection, talk about why you're there, you know, and gave us sort of some hints. And then I thought, well, I can't actually stand up and say, oh, he tangata tiriti aho, because Tūhoe never signed te tiriti. If I go to Tūwharetoa, you know, it wouldn't stick, right? And so that suddenly, so I had to talk about the connections I had with my friend, with his father. And so it was about whanaungatanga, you know, that sort of, and going through lots of pōhiri, it made me rethink a lot of things about just saying, oh, you know, he tangata tiriti, tangata tiriti, tangata tiriti. And so sitting back, these three stories for me were really important because they speak to, I think, these are constitutional moments. Constitutionalism is not waiting for the crown to suddenly be voted in to enact Matike Mai. We should keep pushing it without a doubt. But I think that constitutionalism is much more direct and can be much more direct. It's probably where my whakaaro is at the moment. It's saying that I think constitutional, you know, transformation, or, you know, holding on to these ways of constitutional transformation, as Veronica said, has been happening since forever. And I think that there is a clear legal narrative for this, right? Because it's, you know, the whole purpose of the kāwana was only to set up for Pākehā, actually more specifically British subjects, right? Which I find it fascinating then, because we always use this throwaway phrase, and I've heard in quite a few tiriti workshops, is, you know, we're all here because of te tiriti. Ah, very nice. We're going to be really happy about that. But I think it's probably more accurate to say, I'm here because of a tiriti breach. So what are we going to do about it? You know, and it should make us feel uncomfortable, and actually make us question, you know, the real legitimacy of the crown. Because I don't remember a single time when any iwi, even on the most tokenistic form of consultation, has ever been involved in immigration policy. And yet immigration was such a powerful thing to colonize. So I think that we should remember that context, and to realize that constitutional change has always, you know, happened, that these constitutional systems have always happened. But the second thing is, I think constitutional transformation, rather, is happening right now. I think if you look at things like hui a motu, the upcoming hui at kahungunu, they're very real. This is, you know, these systems are real. I think feeling that sitting in koronehana, I felt that. But perhaps the more important thing as a result of that, and I'm thinking about some of my Asian communities and the work that I've been part of doing that, is actually saying, I think it's actually going to happen, and probably by 2040, potentially. And the reason why I think that is, in terms of having these direct relationships, I think that there is I think constitutional transformation has to be really practical and real. And if you go back to that, you know, story about Pāmoana and his koro, they're very real, right? It's possible to actually benefit this large group, because another way to view it is, the crown that was set up wasn't set up with me in mind. It wasn't set up with my communities in mind, and it doesn't work. And my prediction is, the crown for some has already lost its legitimacy. It doesn't have enough capacity to change all its policies, to translate everything, to take an ethnic lens to things, particularly when you think about the growing population of ethnic people of color, you know. And I think we should be careful about that, you know. That's not to say it's guaranteed, but the system won't actually work for the current kāwana, because it wasn't set up to work for this whole group, to govern this whole group. But I think the more profound thing is, if we start setting up separate systems of direct relationships, if hapū and iwi or mana whenua agree, you know, they can all the there's always a safety valve, which is like, nope, you're always under the kāwana. But is there an option to say, well, if you're in Tūhoe, if you're in, you know, tūwharetoa. Why can't you have a separate system? And the other thing is, all my tax money right now is going to supporting a castle system that I don't really agree with, an immigration system I don't agree with, a foreign policy system I think is kind of quasi-supportive of genocide. I don't support that. So it's not just this, you know, this idea of, oh, we can just, you know, it's this intellectual idea of constitutional transformation. I think that there is a legitimate basis to set up parallel systems, tax systems, that should really make the Crown very worried. And that's the way the political strategy, I think, comes in, is yes, fight the Crown, absolutely. But don't forget that the worry is asking all tauiwi to sit under the Crown. All tauiwi keep coming in and sit under the Crown, and you actually whakamana the Crown by doing that. If you can actually break up the Crown, you know, I don't think that Te Tiriti or Te Whakaputanga ever extinguish the right of iwi or hapū to treat with each other, to make other treaties, or to say with new people coming in, do it under a different tikanga, do it under a different system, pay taxes for that system, or it'll be a different system, doesn't have to be capitalistic at all. And I think that option was never extinguished, you know? So I think that we have to really think about opportunities to break out of just the kawana as the center of all things. And I'm hitting my time, so I wanted to end with this last quote from Avatar, The Last Airbender, by Uncle Iroh. You've seen the TV show, which he, you know, Zuko saying to, you know, Zuko is this learner of the Fire Nation, right? And he's saying, like, Uncle Iroh, why are you teaching me how to bend fire like a water bender and bend fire like an earth bender and so on? And he says, well, Zuko, understanding the others, the other elements and the other nations will help you become whole. And so sometimes, the you know, people might be finding the Crown because we're Asian and we're finding the Crown, or Tangata Moana finding the Crown, Tangata Whenua obviously finding the Crown. But sometimes when you step back and you go, if I understand the other nations, I can actually start to position myself and know really who the enemy is, not to be divided and conquered, not to listen to those narratives. And why can't we have a direct relationship? And base it in, you know, Te Tiriti, base it in Te Whakaputanga, base it in Tino Rangatiranga, and not just get caught up in the kawana is the only solution for everything. And so, yeah, I just probably want to end it there. And yeah, and say that those stories have informed how I think about this. Sure
enough. Namhi mahana, Darryn, for some wonderful stories and are really interesting. Strategic set of ideas. That's quite fascinating to me. Okay, Ngā mihi nui kia Te McCreanor, who describes himself as an activist researcher. Go, Tim.
Kia ora, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa ko Tim McCreanor taku ingoa. He Pākehā hau no Airanga, Kotiana. O Tamaki Makaurau ahau, e noho ana. He kairanga hau I te rōpū whāriki. Thanks so much for those amazing opening contributions, folks. I'm fearful and humbled that I'm not going to have much to add. Though, you know, as a researcher, I have spent some years particularly studying Pākehā talk about Māori, Pākehā talk about Māori-Pākehā relations, and working closely with the team that Helen Waiwaka Barnes has assembled through Te Rōpū Whāriki has given me a set of relationships that is at once profoundly supportive of that, but enabling me to bring those kinds of knowledges into the long study that she's involved in, into the determinants of hauora Māori and how to strengthen and reach the aspirations that Māori and Māori communities have for their health and well-being. So those things are really important, but yeah, I could make some stories, but just to signal that without those relationships, I am nothing. I am small and insignificant in the scheme of things. But Matike Mai came over my horizon in about 2017 when I helped Susan Healy, who's part of Tamaki Treaty Workers, to organise a national hui of Tiriti worker folks to think about and talk about. And we had a full day, and over the expression that came from people was here in clear and straightforward and simple terms is a steering star. And it has very much been that for me in the years since 2017. It helped me to make sense of what was happening for me at Whariki Research Group, but it also has found its way into many, many of the activities and interests and imperatives that come to us as researchers. And I really appreciate Darryn's notion that that constitutionalism is actually quite disseminated into our everyday activities. It's not something alien and abstract. It's something that we are doing, and our constitutional arrangements reflect that really strongly. And so knowing that our constitutional arrangements come from our connections, our behaviours, our practices, is also highly exciting and innovating, in the sense that it means that every corner matters. Everything we do contributes to constitutional change. And so the choices we make, the options we take, can be at that really fundamental level, grassroots, flaxroots level, making the kinds of changes that, as Veronica has pointed out, have long animated Māori society, but Pākehā are slowly starting to catch up. And I suppose that the thing really now is to very much try to enhance and elaborate the uptake and the enactment at this sort of fundamental, everyday, if you like, mundane, banal level, that the messages of Matike Mai are not beyond our grasp, that they are in what we do and in how we do it. And so, one or two examples, and I mean, they will seem a bit pointy-headed, but with my co-researcher, Heather Kane, and two strong Māori researchers, Dominic O'Sullivan and Jackie Kidd, we developed a little kind of tool that's a sort of a toy, but actually people have played with in really creative ways, a thing called critical tiriti analysis, which instead of doing evaluations and assessments in terms of, I don't know, abstract things like treaty principles or the English text of the treaty, it just goes back to the five key elements of Te Tiriti and says, well, how does this stack up against these words? Some really, really constructive and valuable things have come out of that. What I really love about Matike Mai is that it pulls so beautifully and eloquently on he waka putanga, on Te Tiriti, on tikanga, kawa and tikanga, and indeed on UNDRIP, to make an incredibly contemporary but deeply historically rooted understanding of where we need to go and what the basis for it can be and how important Māori understandings of Te Tiriti and our futures together actually are. And I can't actually say this better than the Tongan poet Kalu Mila did at Waitangi in 2024. And so I'm going to ask for a clip of her reading her poem about this to be played. Thank you.
Aroha mai, koutou, for the lack of sound with that video. We will make sure that the URL for that video goes in the chat, because I really liked it too. Okay, I'd like to go back to Veronica and see what your response is to the kōrero of the other two speakers for a start.
Oh, right. Yeah, awesome. One other thing, thank you both so much. Unless, Tim, have you had any, there may have been some comments you wanted to make after Carlo's poem? Or did you just want to reflect on actually what Carlo's poem was about? They might put it in the link later, but yeah, what was the thing with Carlo's poem?
Yeah, maybe just a couple of moments. Look, basically she's saying the thing that tauhi we need to realise and accept and live with and live by is that Māori never ceded sovereignty. Okay, so for me, that becomes a real challenge, to which Matike Mai offers a real, as I said before, like a steering star and a horizon towards Tiriti-based futures. One of the things that Matike Mai did do as well is produce a rough timeline, which was actually fleshed out quite considerably in He Puapua, Claire Charter's wonderful analysis and application of Matike Mai. But the timeline was that by 2024, Pākehā would be, have done lots of work in the kāwanatanga sphere, and we would be ready to interact in a just and constructive and positive relational manner with the tino rangatiratanga sphere. We haven't even started. We have a last gasp in that the big horizon is the 200-year anniversary of the signing of Te Tiriti o Waitangi in 2040. But man, have we got a lot of work to do in the meantime. I thought that we need to really engage in the current situation that we find ourselves in with a hostile, profoundly hostile, overtly hostile government, is that we need to engage, we need to educate ourselves, we need to work together to mobilise Pākehā people and to work with all tauiwi and to work with Māori towards that dream of Tiriti-based futures for all of us that can work for all of us. Kia ora.
Veronica, do you have any comments on the other kōrero?
Yes. Oh, yeah, just to say, you know, absolutely tautoko both of what you said, wonderful reflections. And I think for me as well, you know, the importance of this whānau and making those direct relationships and thinking about what we can do every day is that all of that is profoundly anti-racist work, you know, and it's profoundly anti-racist work because the extension of kāwanatanga over Māori lives as well has required the creating of those myths about that Indigenous inferiority. You know, the idea at that time that Māori didn't have a political system, didn't have a health system, didn't have social wellbeing system, et cetera, et cetera. And so the work that we need to do these days in order to be able to restore tino rangatiratanga is actually, you know, the restoring of that recognition of tikanga and kawe as things that are valuable, you know, as things that have huge contributions to the way that we live our lives here in Aotearoa. And as both of these men have suggested, you know, that's not something that we're going to be able to rely on the kāwanatanga system itself to provide, you know, so that we have this huge task in front of us actually, which is then inherently that anti-racist task, because it is looking back, knowing that these things have value, and then seeking the connections by which we can then begin to actually live these things. You know, these opportunities, as said there, in the everyday. I absolutely love what you were saying there, Darryn, about direct relationships, because that's exactly right. You know, there's nothing in Te Tiriti that prevented us from continuing to do that. And we do have a major challenge there in terms of where people think that the Te Tiriti relationships are only Crown Māori relationships. You know, whānau, that might be true in terms of a Te Tiriti relationship, but actually, you know, people's sense of belonging to this country is deeper than Te Tiriti. And this is what I mean about Te Tiriti just being a document within which, you know, through that provision of rangatiratanga, that promise that how things were, you know, on these lands were going to continue. Well, what are those things? You know, and those are the things that every citizen can connect to through a relationship with where they are, you know, through a relationship with local people. And I always say this to lots of groups that I work with, you know, people like teachers and things like that, who say, well, you know, what can I do to, you know, honor Te Tiriti? And it really just is about going to those deeper levels, whānau, because we say to people, you know, well, where are you right now? You know, where are you when you're standing in front of those, in front of your learners? You know, what connections do you have, you know, to those lands and to the spiritual political authority of those lands, to the stories, to, you know, there's huge things in there. And Whai Margaret Mutu, you know, who obviously you know, led the Matike Mai project with Mauna, she has this great quote where she says, you know, that there's all these kaumātua and kuia all over the country who have all this deep knowledge, you know, about every hill, about every little valley, about every river, and that but because of the way that we've developed as a country since that encroachment of kāwanatanga, is that people don't know, that knowledge isn't recognised. But the way that Whai Margaret frames it is that it's a huge loss, you know, and it's not just lost to Māori, it's lost to everyone in this country. You know, Whai Margaret even has a citizenship narrative about it, you know, that actually to be full citizens of this country in terms of political belonging, you know, responsibilities, obligations, then we need to just forge ahead to, you know, ensure that we have this deep knowing, you know, and this deep connection, and that's going to be outside of whatever the Crown does. And so to continue to forge forward. So I love that too, Tim, you saying, you know, well, actually there's lots of things that we need to do in the everyday, because that actually is where it's going to happen. And just to reflect as well, whānau, that yes, we know that we are in you know, we're in a bit of trouble with regards to who's taken up the latest mantle in kāwanatanga, and just even more just even more encouragement that we must continue to forge forward with a vision that's longer, you know, that's longer than the 3-year messes that we are constantly put in, you know, that's longer than, you know, what are all the details of the coalitions, because those things are definitely harmful, you know. In our time, we need to think how it is that we can minimize whatever harm might be caused, but what is actually that longer term thing that is going to get us there. And even just Mauna constantly, I just watched something from him last night where he was saying, you know, the adversarial nature of what we have, you know, is just something that really, you know, its days are over. You know, we're living in different global times where people are seeking, you know, unity and peace and what might be the basis for kotahitanga, you know, and that, you know, tikanga in terms of, you know, Māori welcoming, and there's just so much depth, breadth and beauty there that we can all really benefit from, but we just must but this is an anti-racist project in terms of it's going to require the rejection of the idea that Māori didn't have democracy here, all those types of things. Yeah, so it's a really long wānanga, whānau, but you know, we can do it.
Kia ora, kia ora. Veronica, we have one question which is also about strategy. And I know that Māori in all kinds of fora have been discussing strategy, as you said, for generations. And this question is about whether we need to help the government build their vision for how the transition could work, right? And so effectively that's asking, do we put our energy into getting the current kāwanatanga to change or to transition, or do we do it some other way? Open to all of you.
I was going to say difficult when it's not the person asking themselves, but my very short answer would be no. Yeah, no. Do either of you men wish to elaborate?
Yeah, no, I see this as a long-term project. I mean, there are short-term things that we can do and will do. Darren's really clear about that, and Veronica too. But like as a researcher, I'm thinking what I've been exposed to and talked about and tried to articulate is the limited array of discourses that Pākehā have to talk about these issues. And so discourses make our worlds, discourses can change our worlds. And so by generating exactly the kind of talk that Matike Mai is hard at work in doing, and doing it across the board, across the generations, particularly with the younger generations, we resource a different kind of future, and that is very much what we need to do. Kia ora.
Yeah, I don't talk about both of that, because there's so much that's outside, and again, it's hard without a group that's self-reflective. But I also find that the kawana is set up in such a powerful way to sort of absorb anything in its orbit and just is able to reinterpret it again and again, you know. I think it's also interesting to whether we want to call it the kawana or just a kawana. And I think that, you know, the point of Te Whakaputanga Article 2, right, was that, you know, there could be always a delegation to a particular group that could be a kawana. So I think the extension of direct relationship is how far do you want to go? Because if the purpose, if colonization was always the kawana that then expanded itself, rather than trying just tinker with it, the purpose should really be to narrow down the kawana, right? And if that looks like multiple kawana that sit within the Tangata Tiriti sphere, why not, you know? And we shouldn't just keep, again, there's like not focusing on the kawana, but can we pressure the kawana to make it smaller? Because I'll give a practical example is, If I and someone who is mana whenua of a particular area have a dispute, why are we going to the courts? Like, even if you have a Māori judge or an Asian judge, you know, the system's not built for us to resolve our disputes there. And it actually benefits the kawana to not have to deal with that because the court's already clogged up. It's not helping anyone. Having these alternatives institutions, kawana maybe, you know, it will actually benefit the kawana. So sometimes I think the strategy might also be to invest in other systems that actually push the kawana down and force its hand to get smaller and return to its original mandate that Te Tiriti actually allowed for it, would be my thoughts.
Yeah, and I don't, I definitely, obviously, you know, in the we need a plan, you know, with regards to the transition. So it's not that I disagree with the question, but it's who we do that with. Yeah, because I don't think, you know, there's any point in doing that with kāwanatanga or currently who's in kāwanatanga. You know, definitely, you know, strategy in terms of what is the transition, what are those things going to look like? But I think that that's something that is done with Aotearoa, you know, with all of us, as opposed to working with kāwanatanga itself at this stage. You know, that will come, but it certainly isn't where our initial energies should be. You know, we have massive tasks before us with regards to conscientization and even envisaging what that might look like before we get to that stage.
Veronica, I have a question which you may not feel is relevant right now. I know that there's been a whole heap of kōrero among Māori in a whole range of ways since Matike Mai about a decolonised future that the whole consultation envisaged. Have Māori developed any further strategies or any preferences for a particular vision? Like Matike Mai had several models of how a decolonised Aotearoa based on Te Tiriti could work, and I'm just wondering where Māori thinking is about that now, because it has been some time since 2016.
Yeah, well, I certainly couldn't talk for the entire Māori nation, but what I can tell you is that, and as an educator, I am a Te Tiriti educator whānau. But as an educator, I can tell you, you know, that some of the things that we have been involved in terms of, you know, the introduction of Matike Mai into our teaching, you know, into our Tiriti teaching. And I think it's really important, both in terms of what Tim and Darryn were saying with regards to, I loved what you said, Tim, about, you know, that it gave you a star, that it gave you like a guiding star to work towards. And I know that in all my work as a Te Tiriti educator, one of the things that Mariana Pittman taught us was that it's really important to have not, she didn't phrase it in terms of just hope, but it's that, you know, we're in such an a really dire state, lots of our communities. You know, we're in real you know, trouble in lots and lots of ways. And what we can, while it's important to relay to everyone, you know, how that happened, so that we can continue to, you know, work on our anti-racism in terms of, you know, it's not just because Māori are naturally violent or are naturally poor, are naturally hopeless, you know. So it's important to explain colonization in terms of being able to reject those things and sort of link those things to, you know, the structural establishment of Māori as a lower oppressed, you know, poor class. What it is that we also, though, however, must give people hope in terms of, and then what? Okay, so we understand that's happened, but actually what is it that we work towards? And so, you know, explaining to people not only all the historical constitutional initiatives that Māori have had in place that I discussed right at the beginning of this, but also that this is continues to be the answer to a more just Aotearoa. So even just introducing people to Matike Mai Aotearoa and letting them know, hey, that there's a plan, you know, there is a plan, there is a solution. You know, there is a you know, clear vision with regards to a better future, has been something quite important in terms of making sure that there's an education project, you know, a conscientization project that's inherent in this work. And so from what I do know, you know, is that, you know, right around the motu with different amongst different hapū and different iwi, is that there are massive education projects being launched, you know, with regards to what does, you know, tino rangatiratanga mean in that particular area. It might be that it's not referred to as that, you know, there might be mana motuhake, you know, mana whakahaere, might be the different ways that it's referred to, you know, what was the relationship of Te Tiriti specifically to that area. This is the other really exciting thing, whānau, is that not only are we becoming more mature in our understanding of Te Tiriti nationally, you know, through the work of the tribunal around those provisions, but also what did it mean specifically where we are, you know, and then what does that mean in terms of our future? And I think, you know, that we just really, really need to support those efforts, you know, that is about, you know, restoring tino rangatiratanga is what is actually happening differently, you know, might be differently, but locally at those different, in our different regions here, you know, on these islands in the Pacific, which is where we are, whānau, you know, what's actually happening in these different places that we can support, that is about, you know, yes, yeah, supporting the tino rangatiratanga in those areas. But yeah, from that's what I know. So we have some very exciting things going on, whānau. In addition to that, Jenny, I will just say, that in addition to the education elements that we're beginning to see in lots of different areas that are hapū and iwi led, is that I've also just noted, this is just myself personally, that there have been some absolutely amazing, inspiring displays of tino rangatiratanga, you know, by local hapū and iwi. And I will just refer to a couple of examples because they are public examples. But for example, I remember first feeling that way when Ngāti Whātua and the Kingitanga put out a joint statement about their relationship. So people may have been aware there was a bit of a public display of disunity at Te Matatini, you know, which was, you know, that was their, you know, about a current conflict, and then that they put out the statement together about the kotahitanga and where they do sit alongside. I thought that was absolutely amazing. We then had things like down in Te Atiawa where they hosted a hui for all Māori public servants in Wellington. You know, it didn't matter where those Māori public servants were from or that they worked for government. They were like, you're working on our land. So they had a hui with them. Just absolutely amazing. In addition to all these hui a motu, you know, that have been happening. And so I think there's really, you know, exciting displays, whānau, where people are actually just exercising, you know, that rangatiratanga and, you know, and the role of everyone in those areas is to support, you know, what that might be a million different ways that it can be supported. So I think not so much, Jenny, in terms of, you know, right, like nationally, are we going to have this plan? What's the structure going to look like, et cetera, et cetera? That there's actually, you know, lots of deep and beautiful layers and you know, that we need to, you know, engage with and work through, and that's already happening, you know, in addition to continuing to work on that long-term thing. Like everyone will be aware, we are having our next constitutional hui at Auckland University in a couple of weeks. Yep, and the United Nations Special Rapporteur, I believe, is going to be in attendance. Yeah, so we've got those things all happening, whānau, but I wouldn't sit back and wait, you know, for the structure or the model or what it's going to look like, because we have that huge task of conscientization, actually bringing people into awareness and then beginning to live it every day, as these men have talked about, is a major primary task. And we can worry about transitioning kāwanatanga later.
Okay, we've been able to recover the video of Carlo, and we'll play that after 9:30 for those of you who are able to stay. For those of you who aren't, I want to say ngā mihi nui ki ngā kaikōrero there for a wonderfully expansive and you just inspiring kōrero. And to the volunteers and partners who created this event, a recording of this webinar will be uploaded to YouTube in about a month and announced on the Te Tiriti Based Futures and Anti-Racism Facebook group. To close, I'd like to quote words from Papa Moana Jackson from the Matike Mai report. What is available to both Māori and the Crown and to all of us from the kōrero of this process of consultation is its generosity of spirit. And the belief that the many practical and social obstacles to transformation can be overcome and a new constitution can be established. Throughout the 4 years of discussion that led to the Matike Mai report, all those participants saw a new constitution as the legitimate treaty expectation. So my whakatauki that I thought would be useful for this mahi is mā tene, mā mono, ka rapa, rapu, te whai. By many, by thousands, we will attain our goals. Thank you. Thank you. And good morning. Now, let's have the video.
As Tangata Tiriti, we've got to realise Māori never ceded sovereignty. Yet we have a history rewritten as peaceful acquisition, a narrative of natural superiority, disputed history, dishonoured tiriti, principles nullified, muted, neutered into some kind of policy preamble, bureaucratic mumbo jumbo, making neutral magic. If ever there was an illegible language that says too much and means nothing, it is this: authoritatively bringing valid to the invalid, softly and sensibly bringing legal legitimacy to the illegal, all the while talking law and order, disassociating from its own history, projecting warrior gene violence onto its collective victims. And yes, we have the same people policing exactly the same privilege, still guarding the spoils of war, as if the main crimes we are facing now are against property, not a people dispossessed of the right to rule, of the right to hold on to resources that fed and housed and homed them for centuries. As if this is not theft, as if this is not stealing, as if this is not against some kind of law. But how can it be when we tau iwi right them to make ourselves right? The most important thing for tau iwi to know consciously is that Māori never ceded sovereignty. How do we respond ethically when it calls our own validity and authority into question? How do we stand upright here? The only answer is Te Tiriti, signed in good faith, and it guides us article by article. As tauiwi, we can participate in democracy that doesn't elect hypocrisy, doesn't neglect history, as it rewrites intergenerational legacy with no idea of its caucasity, looking in a mirror and seeing only its own reflection. We are a Te Tiriti partner, and we are born into this, and we are lucky. This is the agreement that offers us inclusion and belonging. So may kawanatanga rise to its promise of good governance. May tino rangatiratanga breathe in every way beyond the page. Hearts, minds, spirit, land, leadership, taonga katoa. As tauiwi, we stop, silence ourselves, listen, learn what tino rangatiratanga really means, what te whakaputanga really means. Ask ourselves the question. Ask David the question. Ask every politician the question, what tino rangatiratanga really means, and then live the answers to these questions. That's our work, as well as ensuring in every way tangata whenua experience the same rights and privileges as British subjects in every way. Economic, health, housing, life expectancy, the whole holistic gamut in every way. That's our work, and that's what we signed up to.
Awesome.
Hello, blows me away. I've said my farewell, I've said my whakatauki, so I'd just like to tell anybody who's still remaining with us to travel well and think hard about what you've heard today.
Hāpai tātou.
Kia ora. Kia pai.